गुड मॉर्निंग ऑल फ्रॉम द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ रेडियो डायग्नोसिस एन के पी सिम्स नागपुर. दिस इज़ आवर 10th लाइव वर्कशॉप ऑर्गेनाइज बाय द डिपार्टमेंट अलॉन्ग विद MSBRI MCR. एंड वी आर हैप्पी टू शेयर दैट दिस हैज़ बीन कंटिन्यूसली सपोर्टेड बाय सैमसंग इंडिया. वी आर थैंकफुल टू दैम. टूडे वी आर doing our workshop on normal venous Doppler of the lower limb along with evaluation of varicose veins, and this will be followed by demonstration of laser ablation of the varicose veins. I am Dr. Prashant Onkar, Associate Professor in NKP SIMS, and along with me is Dr. Ashish Ambhore. He is a trained intervention radiologist and lecturer in our department. So I will be doing the normal and varicose veins Doppler demo, and he'll be doing the laser ablation today. At this point, I want to thank all, including WatchWiz Technologies, who have been supporting us in live transmission of these videos. All MSBRI office bearers who have supported since last 1 year, and we hope we have contributed a little bit in enhancing the capacities of our young radiologists and students across India. We are also thankful to the management of NKP SIMS for supporting us from day one and giving us free hand to organize all these webinars for you. So we will have a small presentation on venous Doppler, and then we will start the demo. Thank you. We will just rush through the key points in Doppler evaluation of varicose veins. First and foremost is just keep your probe steady. We are in the habit of doing ultrasound abdomen, obstetrics, pelvis, and as we need to scan large organs, we keep the probe moving. Here the area of interest is very small, hardly 5 millimeters, 10 millimeters or so. So we need to keep probe steady and follow the course of the vessel. Whenever you are seeing veins or arteries in the abdomen, you can compress and to dodge the gases, and you can take oblique views and all. But in lower limb or upper limb, you need not compress the veins. In fact, that is not indicated, and compression is to reveal normalcy of the vein. Always start with B mode, start in a transverse view, and use the planes and relation with other vessels to identify the veins. As regards patient positioning, one important factor is patient should be head down. Head down means he should be resting comfortably on the pillow. That inhibits the inadvertent Valsalva if the patient is raising his head and trying to see what you are doing. Then patient is lying in supine, and we look for venous anatomy and compressibility. And for perforators, if required, we can use a sitting posture or standing posture. In addition to that, a reverse Trendelenburg position, if it is possible, you should use it. In a practical experience, 80 to 90% venous insufficiency can be demonstrated by using supine posture or sitting posture. If it is not possible, then at the end of the examination, you can just ask the patient to stand up and do the evaluation for incompetence. The veins show certain B mode characteristics, and as we start with B mode, we should look for the wall motion, which is phasic rather than pulsatile, and lumen should be clear of contents, and of course from the CFE, that is common femoral vein, down to the TVLs, they should be compressible. You cannot assess compressibility in iliac and IVC, but you must do it from femoral downwards. When we describe the vein, the part of the vein away from the heart is distal, and the proximal is towards the heart. This is just the reverse as we describe for the arteries. Again, head should be down, that means patient should be relaxing or comfortable on the bed. while tracing the veins, if you are lost, just come back where you were seeing that vein properly. And if there is a chance, if the disease is unilateral, definitely you can do comparison with the other side. So these are the features shown by veins in the flow. That is, the flow is spontaneous, it is phasic, and it shows respiratory variation. We will see it during the demo. The pulsatile flow, you can see it sometimes, that is due to right heart volume overload. And a continuous flow, like we see in portal vein in liver cirrhosis, can be due to the proximal venous obstruction. Some other features that can be tested to see the patency of the vein are Valsalva maneuver and distal augmentation. The Valsalva maneuver you can do in lower limb till the popliteal vein level, where the abdominal pressure, increase in abdominal pressure, will stop the flow in the vein. And this should be seen, and this confirms the patency of that part of the vein right from heart up to that segment. And as regards distal augmentation is another test wherein you creep a probe, identify the vein, and do the augmentation at a lower level. For example, if you are seeing a femoral vein, you can compress the popliteal or the calf to increase the flow in the vein, and that way you confirm the patency of the vein in between the probe position and the point of compression. So if you are doing calf vein analysis, then you can compress the lower leg. And if you are doing the lower leg, you can compress the foot likewise. Coming to the deep veins, we know there are three pair of veins in the leg: posterior tibial, anterior tibial, and peroneal. They join eventually and form the popliteal vein, which is joined by the short saphenous vein, and this enters the adductor canal and is called superficial femoral vein, where it is joined by the deep femoral vein and the great saphenous vein. The common femoral one enters the pelvis, and it is external iliac vein, which is joined by internal iliac to form the common iliac vein, and both common iliac vein join to form the IVC. So while doing venous Doppler, ideally you should start from IVC, and up to the TBL you should do the evaluation. This is just to ensure. Many people, they start from common femoral in venous as well as arterial evaluation, but it is always prudent to start with IVC, and it should be practiced, because you have to rule out the abnormalities at this level. One word about TBL veins. TBL veins many a time show spontaneous flow like other veins, but when there is a limb edema or in response to cold, we don't see a spontaneous flow. The vein is compressible. If you try compression with the probe, the vein is compressible, but there is no flow. In that case, the augmentation maneuver comes to our rescue, and we can do that and identify the flow in the veins. Sometimes we are in the habit of putting pressure on the probe while doing abdominal and other ultrasounds. For doing venous evaluation, the probe pressure has to be minimal or zero, and that is also sometimes cause that we are not able to detect vein in the superficial detect flow in the superficial veins. Foot veins as such are not routinely imaged. Still, this is a diagram of foot veins, and we should know that there are perforators in foot veins as such. The superficial venous system has the larger vein, that is the great saphenous or long saphenous, and the shorter vein, that is the short saphenous or small saphenous vein. The GSV is the longest vein in the body and forms at the around the medial malleolus and extends up to almost up to the inguinal ligament level. It has got multiple tributaries like the circumflex veins in the thigh, circumflex veins in the calf, and the accessory GSVs, the anterior and the posterior one. So we should know about them, and we should try to evaluate whenever there is reflux. If there is no reflux suspected, you need not put more attention to them. The short saphenous or the small saphenous vein, then it extends from the lateral malleolus and ends by entering into the popliteal vein in the popliteal fossa. Sometimes this vein extends up into the thigh and through the circumflex that it enters the GSV, and then it is called vein of Giacomini or the intracephenous vein, now it is called. Venous incompetence is widely researched but still not completely understood. We know there are walls in the veins, and there are walls in between superficial and deep veins. This is the natural mechanism to prevent reflux, especially when a person is standing. And incompetence at all these levels, that is in between superficial and deep veins, in the perforators or in the walls of the superficial veins, there is a reflux or incompetence, so that allows the blood to go back into the dependent part, and then the causes the venous dilatation. So what happens? There is increase in the venous pressure, and there is a long column of blood because of gravity. This leads to the leakage of protein fluid and blood cells to the capillary walls. This causes edema, skin thickening, and hyperpigmentation that you see in a patient with varicosities. The saphenopopliteal and the saphenosophemoral junction incompetence is many a times an early sign, and it is very well evaluated by Doppler. Coming to the types of varicose veins, it can be primary or secondary. Primary, sometimes there is no walls or congenitally absent, it is called avalvulation. It's quite rare. But the incompetence of walls of the superficial venous system and the perforator vein is the main cause for the primary varicosities. Secondarily is always a post thrombotic or post thrombophlebitic, because the walls are disrupted during the disease process, and then there is development of secondary varicose veins. So whenever a patient comes with varicosities, you must ask them history of deep vein thrombosis or acute limb swelling. In varicose veins, there is usually reluctance amongst us to look for the or to attempt looking for causes and effects of varicose veins. Why this is? Because there is a variation in technique. The nomenclature is not definite. Different countries, they use different nomenclature. There are types of primary, secondary. The predictable path is not there. For example, in a arterial obstruction, you know which could be collaterals and how they would go. Here, the development of varicosities or development of perforators is not very predictable every time. Sometimes you will have intramuscular pathway, sometimes you will have posterior path, likewise. So therefore, the large area needs to be scanned right from groin to the malleolus or foot, and you need to have positions. We have to scan in supine, we can scan in sitting, sometimes in standing. Various maneuvers need to be done. So the learning curve is little bit slow, and people find it time consuming. But let me assure you, once you master it, it is quite rewarding, and it doesn't take much time. Some people have described scanning the superficial venous system like scanning a plate of spaghetti, where you just move your probe and everywhere you see veins. It is not like that. If you know where to look for, it becomes quite easy. This is a list of clinical features as per severity in case of the CAP classification, and the symptoms, they start from telangiectasia, the varicose veins, and edema, and skin changes, and there is then ulcer formation, which could be healed ulcer or active ulcer, and then patient has symptoms. So our role in chronic venous insufficiency or varicose veins is preoperative evaluation. The intraoperative performance of this catheter-based procedure, we will see a demo today, and of course postoperative evaluation of the effectiveness of ablation. So our role in evaluation of varicose veins is to rule out deep venous thrombosis, that is first and foremost. We have to find the source of reflux, from where the reflux is coming. We have to define the path of reflux. If the path reflux is occurring, how it is progressing, or where is it going. There, in addition, detection of junctional incompetence, tortuosity or thrombus in the superficial veins, the detection of perforators and incompetence amongst them, and to rule out associated thrombophlebitis or associated pathology. कमिंग टू टेक्निक एज सच यू शुड फॉलो अ प्रोटोकॉल वाइल डूइंग इवेल्युएशन ऑफ सेफेनोफेमोरल जंक्शन. फर्स्ट लोकेट द जंक्शन, देन यूज प्रॉपर प्रोब पोजिशन, रिड्यूस द प्रेशर एंड देन यूज वंस यू आइडेंटिफाई द वेन, यूज अ कलर बॉक्स, स्टीयर इट प्रॉपरली सो दैट यू सी द ऑप्टिमम फीलिंग, एडजस्ट द स्केल सो दैट देर इज फ्लो इज सीन नाइसली. You can, if required, you adjust the gain, color gain, and ask the patient to Valsalva. On Valsalva, the flow should cease, or there could be reflux. Once you have done this, then put spectral Doppler spectral gate across the vein. Then use the scale to adjust, and then use the spectral gain, and again do Valsalva. If there is reflux, just measure the time for which there is reflux, and if there is reflux, you can evaluate the tributaries of the GSV. If there is reflux in the GSV, so we have to check certain things. The reflux is from common femoral to SFJ to GSV, or reflux is GSV and as well as the tributaries like the accessory saphenous vein or circumflex saphenous vein. Or whether there is reflux from the epigastric vein to GSV or any other superficial inguinal tributary, and whether there is isolated reflux in the superficial inguinal territory. So all these things they come into play whenever there is reflux. GSV, we'll cover this in the demo, that how GSV is located in the fascia and how the appearance is, and even the short saphenous vein is also in a fascia that is called Egyptian eye, and it can be visualized, and the tributaries of these veins, they are superficial, always superficial to it. So whenever they are dilated, it becomes easy for us to evaluate different planes. The deep veins will be below the muscular plane, the superficial GSV and SSV will have their own fascia, and the tributaries will be more superficial to that. Certain provocative maneuvers we use, as I have discussed. Valsalva maneuver is for the veins of the proximal thigh. Up to the saphenopopliteal junction, you can use Valsalva maneuver to see the patency in the common femoral, superficial femoral, popliteal vein, and both junctions. Some people advocate use of this Parana maneuver, wherein the patient that is done in a standing position, and not many people use it. Distal compression and release is used for distal veins and on the perforators also. If there is rapid antegrade flow with compression followed by retrograde flow, then we can term it as reflux. Some people advocate use of proximal compression, that is pressure on the vein superior to the probe. To this can cause the incompetent wall to fail, but most people advocate this rapid antegrade flow with compression technique. If their patient has edema, then patient should be asked to do dorsal plantar flexion of the foot to check for this reflux. The saphenopopliteal junction example, how the flow will cease when the patient does Valsalva, and this is the normal response to Valsalva at the junction as well as in the veins, major veins. The competence due to incompetence, there will be direct change in the direction of the blood flow. Instead of stopping here, the blood flow is seen on the other side, and you can see it here in both examples. The saphenofemoral junction is incompetent, and you can measure the time for which there is reflux. Same is true for the perforator. You can do a distal squeezing or proximal compression to see for reflux. Then again, timing of the reflux is given. They say at SFJ, one more than 1 centimeter should be taken abnormal, and in the perforator more than 0.5 second should be taken abnormal. There is no consensus as such, but many people give these figures. Then there can be intravenous reflux. Intravenous reflux means on Valsalva you can see change in direction of the vein. This is a femoral vein that was showing normal flow. You see red here. It was going towards this direction, towards heart, but on Valsalva you can see there is change in direction. This indicates there is insufficiency and there are some perforators, those are giving rise to this ding dong type of flow. This sometimes there are other causes of this intravenous reflux that is many a time seen in obese patients or overweight patients, and sometimes in post-traumatic or post-traumatic patients. So, and this could be a combination of things, but whenever you see this, instead of stopping the flow, if there is reflux of flow, you must check, try to check for perforators or incompetence along the junctions. The perforators are conventionally given names like Cockett, Boyd, Dodds, Hunters. Cockett, Boyd, Dodds are in the calf region and Hunter is in the adductor compartment or lower thigh. Some people advocate anatomical nomenclature of these perforators, and they label them as thigh perforators, and on the medial side as anterior tibial, paratibial, posterior tibial, and in the lateral side multiple names have been given. So it's your choice to use the nomenclature, and the nomenclature with which you are the referring physician is familiar with, you can use them. These are just some types I found in one of the article. They have given not types, there are patterns that you can anticipate in a case of venous reflux. There can be isolated junction incompetence at the SFJ or SPJ, or there can be isolated perforator incompetence. Mind you, there can be normal SFJ or normal SPJ, but there could be varicosities and incompetent perforator sometimes. So it's not that both should be coexistent. So you have to evaluate it that way. Rarely pelvic venous incompetence, they causes lower extremity varices, and that you should try to see when there is no incompetence at these two veins junctions and the superficial veins are normal, then try to see whether it is coming from the pelvic region. And sometimes there can be combination, there can be incompetence, there can be varicosities and all. Normally this is a normal perforator. You see it is going away from the probe, going down into from superficial to deep, and after the compression the flow has augmented and then stop. There is no reflux here. So this is the normal response of the perforator to distal compression, and this is the abnormal response. You can see that there is change in direction. This was going down in from superficial to deep, now it is showing the from flow from deep to superficial. So again the flow more than a certain time and perforator size more than 3.5 mm is taken as abnormal. This is another example of a very large perforator. You can see it's tortuous also. This is a point of perforation that I will demonstrate in the case, and this is how there can be a incompetence demonstrated by spectral Doppler. So you need to demonstrate on color as well as spectral Doppler. Certain unusual causes of varicose veins are there, and whenever you don't find the normal or the common things, then these things may be looked for or suspected. They include vulvoperineal varicosities or intraosseous perforating vein incompetence, round ligament varicosities, sometimes persistent sciatic veins, and that is incompetent, and of course Klippel-Trenaunay syndrome, which is a rare pathology. Sometimes we see that vein is competent in some parts but reflux is not seen. So what to do? We should remember that there has to be a source of reflux, otherwise why the vein should reflux? So segmental reflux is very rare. So we need to check in various planes for the incompetent tributaries, or whether there is very slow valvular leak. There is a valvular leak but you are not able to see because you are not applied proper technical parameters. And again ask the patient to change position from supine to sitting or sitting to standing, and then again try to see that. And finally try to look whether there is a pelvic source for these varicosities. So what our report should include? Our report should include whether DVT is there or not. The old DVT, you should for that you need to screen the deep venous system first completely, and then you can label it as a primary varicosities or secondary varicose veins. Then the saphenofemoral junction, whether it is competent, the time, if there is deep venous reflux, the SPJ, whether it is there or not, if it is incompetent or competent, and whether the SSV is continuing or it is just terminating in the popliteal vein. When SFJ is incompetent, again tributaries evaluation is required, and both accessory veins you should see for incompetence. Perforators in the thigh, perforators in the ankle, as per location, as per nomenclature, you should mention them. You should mention whether they are incompetent, you should mention their diameter, and if incompetent, time for which there is incompetence. Then we can mention the GSV diameter, whether that is increased or not, and whether there is a thrombus anywhere in the superficial venous system as such. So it is said that the visual appearance of the leg is like looking at the tip of the iceberg in case of varicose veins, but ultrasound Doppler and a diligent radiologist is a gold standard in determining chronic venous insufficiency, and we should all practice it regularly. Keep seeing them, so you make it makes your eyes to look for and understand the venous anatomy, venous pathology. Sometimes there are variations, and once your techniques are set, then it is not a difficult ball game altogether. So we end our lecture here, and request you all of you to subscribe and visit the MS Behra MCI YouTube channel, and we have uploaded all the videos, live videos of earlier 9 workshops there, and we need your feedback also, whether they have found useful, and if any other workshops or lectures are required, we'll be happy to do in future. So thank you all. We'll start a normal patient now.